I'd like to welcome you all officially to the memorial service of Dad. Well, let's start with prayer. Lord, would you join me? I'll ask God to be with us.
Let's just bow our heads. Dear Lord, we want to just thank you for bringing us all here to this very sad time, but a time of celebration as we remember a life well lived. I just pray now, Jesus, that you'll be with us and comfort us. And may we leave this place with hope. In your name, amen.
Amen. So for those of you who don't know, this is my boss and my pastor, Pastor Lloyd.
Boss. Am I really boss?
That's the official story. So these two lovely ladies here, my dad's sisters.
Yeah, I know them.
Pat and Esther, yep. And Pat's husband, Chris.
Know him.
Right. And the rest are all Hunts by blood. So Philip and Linda, Damon and Renee are his children, and Zaya is John's granddaughter. So
great granddaughter.
That's right. Philip's the grandfather. And next to that's my beautiful daughter Shani, and my beautiful daughter Jess, and that's Jordan. So Harrison would love to be here, but he's in Darwin, and the quarantine for 2 weeks in and out, as he would have had to done 4 weeks to come and go. So we'll send him the live stream, and of course my beautiful wife Jackie. So we're going to start with Dad's life sketch. So Pat, would you come forward and read that for us now? Thank you.
A few years ago, John gave me a copy of a little sketch of his life that he'd written. Because I wasn't even born till he was about 15, there's a lot of his life that I didn't know about. So I've used that story that he gave me as a basis of most of this, and the rest of it, of course, I made from my memory. So this is a life sketch of John William Hunt, who lived from October the 16th, 1932, to the 31st of July, 2020. John was born in the district of Nottingham on the 16th of October, 1932, to Caroline Nee Reynolds and John Bedard. He was the first and only child of John Bedard, who passed away while John was still an infant. Caroline later married Charles Hunt, a previous boyfriend. Caroline and Charles added three daughters, Dorothy, Esther and Pat, to the family. During his teen years, John changed his name from Bedard to Hunt. John's parents, Caroline and Charlie, became Seventh-day Adventists when John and his sister Dorothy were small children. Each Sabbath, the little family would travel by bus to one of the church members' homes and later a church building where they would have church and then lunch together. Charles and Caroline moved many times. One of their moves was to Newbold College when John was about 7 years of age. It was while living at Newbold that John first fell in love with organ music, and the desire to play and own an organ was fulfilled later on in his life. It was here too that John's love of nature developed, as the Newbold estate offered opportunity for him to roam the fields and woods. This idyllic life came to an end in 1939 when the war began, and Charles was required to do military service, which meant the family had to leave Newbold and move back north. Charles was away from home for long periods of time, and Mum Caroline had to work long hours. John had the responsibility of taking his little sister Dorothy, caring for her in the morning, getting her breakfast, and taking her to the babysitter before he went to school. By the age of 10, John's singing voice was developing well, and he sang often for church. The family moved again when Charles was no longer required in the war service, and John attended another school. It was here that he changed his name to Hunt. After many adventures during his grammar school years, John's final exam results gave him entry into university. However, there were no funds, so this was out of the question. Loving the outdoor life, John decided he would be a farmer. He obtained a farm job, which went well for a while, but after some bad experiences, he decided to settle for an indoor job. He became articled to an accountant and studied bookkeeping, etc. while receiving no pay for the first year and then very little pay for the second year. After one or two other clerical jobs, time for national service arrived. As a conscientious objector, John was assigned to working in a hospital. There were many interesting experiences that came out of those 4 years of hospital work, after which he was finally released from compulsory service. A brief earlier experience at selling bedtime stories convinced John that he would do well in sales. John went to London and enrolled in a sales course. Having Sabbath off always presented problems, but eventually John was able to obtain a job as a sales manager in a company whose owner was Jewish. John was very successful at his job and was well rewarded. But as his wage increased, he realized that a larger portion of it was going into tax. At one point, the tax man was getting the larger share. By this time, John had been married for a few years to his sweetheart, Margaret Swain. John's parents, Charles and Caroline, had immigrated to Australia with sisters Dorothy, Esther and Pat, and they were encouraging John and Margaret to follow. Australia sounded so good that it was all too tempting. In 1959, they made up their minds, sold their house and sailed for Sydney, where they were met by Charles, Caroline, Dorothy, Esther and Pat. John didn't take long to find work in sales, and Margaret, who was a very skilled PA, also obtained work at the Wurunga SDA School and the South Pacific Division office in Wurunga. Later on, two sons were born, Andrew and Philip. Even though the family had settled in Pennant Hills in Sydney, John's sales work took him all over Australia. He was constantly travelling. He eventually grew tired of staying in motels, so he purchased a camper. While they were still small children, Andrew and Philip were often taken on his sales trips in the camper. John enjoyed exploring the Australian countryside while on his sales trips. On one such trip, he discovered a beautiful piece of land at the top of a mountain near Esk in Queensland. He fell in love with this land and purchased it for their retirement. Each time his travels took him north, he would camp on his land. While still in his 50s, John took an early retirement due to health problems, and he and Margaret swapped city life in Sydney for the peaceful life on top of their mountain. They enjoyed many happy years in this glorious location. They were very involved in the Esk Church, playing the organ and piano, singing in the choir, leading out in Sabbath school and preaching. Sadly, Margaret became sick with melanoma and after struggling for a year or two, lost her battle, leaving John alone on his mountain with just his two little dogs for company. John was devastated. Over the next couple of years, the normally optimistic, cheery, happy person became very lonely and depressed. But all this was about to change. An old friend in England, Audrey Brown, had heard through a mutual friend that John was on his own. She phoned John from England one evening and the two talked for a couple of hours. This was the beginning of a long phone friendship that blossomed into love. Finally, Audrey came to Australia to visit John and within a few weeks they were married. Over the next few years, John and Audrey moved house three times in Queensland, eventually settling into a retirement village in Toowoomba. In 2019, when failing health made it important for them to be closer to a nursing facility and family support, they moved to the retirement village in Currumbong and a few months later into the nursing home. The last 12 months have been difficult for John, who has had many health problems, including a fracture followed by a hip replacement, which left him unable to walk. He has remained cheery and positive until the last few weeks, when life became a daily struggle. He died peacefully and quickly on Friday morning, the 31st of July. He was a couple months short of 88 years of age. His friendly and lovable personality won him a wide circle of friends. His life has been a wonderful blessing and powerful influence to many people. He was a devoted, caring husband and fantastic father to his two sons. He loved his God and his church. He fought a good fight. We have this assurance that we will see him again soon. Sleep well, dear one.
Thank you, Pat. That's beautiful.
I learned some things there.
Well, at this point I want to acknowledge Audrey. That's Dad's second wife. It's very sad that she can't be here today. She brought him so much happiness. In fact, I attribute the last 10 years of Dad's life, I attribute to the conversations that started, the friendship that developed, and ultimately the wedding that they had together. I think if Dad hadn't met Audrey, I think he probably would have passed away up on the top of the hill 5 or 10 years ago. So we're very grateful for the lease of life that she brought him, and I'm sorry he can't be here today. She's overwhelmed with grief. She'd like to be here, but I think these last 12 months have been hard on her because she's seen him decline, and she's been visiting him every few days, and I think it just became too much for her, so she's at Avondale House now. We'll send her this video and she'll get to see that we loved him and that we gave him a good send-off. Okay. I'm good. Thank you. Oh, I love him so much. Anyway, I'm going to play a little video for you guys now that Flip and I put together. Just some pictures. So we've got a couple of iPads. Some of you, I emailed it to you already, so you guys can just watch it on your phones. So, Phil, would you give me a hand? We'll grab an iPad each. Keep your soundtrack off. I've got the soundtrack on this little speaker. Thank you.
in yet? Yeah. All right, Phil, can you kill that iPad for me? Thanks. I meant to start today with, on behalf of Philip and I, because together we put this together. Phil chose not to speak today. That's probably a smart move.
We don't
love you, mate.
Right. It's all right.
So we excluded all of Dad's friends today because of coronavirus. Dad's best friend that I knew of was Max Wood. Max and Gwen were great friends of his. And Max has written a poem, which I thought was pretty cool. So it's on the back of the program sheet. Please feel free to take a couple, a souvenir, memento, whatever. I'm going to attempt to read it. If I fail, Jackie can read it. So here goes. Two 10-pound poms from Nottingham. I remember them first at Church Point, where John was building a boat. I assumed he was a chippy, but he was also sewing a coat. John had abilities, hobbies and interests, possessed by very few. A spectrum of crafts and knowledge like no one I knew. Most knew him for his keyboard skills. His solo bass voice was not so well known. He knew of paintbrush and needlework, and his cooking for great taste and smell. In his teens, he trained as an army nurse. Not everyone would know. Except here in Australia, designed fine lace for bridal gowns, which many stores did show. He traded in most of Australia. His clients all welcomed his call, and if a key board available, would certainly draw crowds at lunchtime in the mall. To accomplish more each working day, drove a camper van, not a car. He would drive long into the night, allowing early calls afar. Life in the confined space of a combi van was a challenge in many ways, so John made use of every nook and planned for the number of days. Breakfast all in one service packs, two pieces of toast each morning, single service only of a spread with a lark, of any spread with lark, a small portion of corn. Cut the handle down of each toothbrush, count the shaves from each blade, underwear washed and dried each night, no matter where he stayed. We accompanied the hunts to England, that's Max and Gwen Wood, but Philip and I, we went on a camper van trip with them through England. It was a four berth caravan, and we put six people in it. Don't know how they put up with ours. Anyway, we accompanied the hunts to England, 3 weeks in a mobile camper. The small Bedford van carried us all, six of us, day and night, somewhat cramped. The details of that trip John planned was complete in every way, encompassed England, Scotland, Wales, through suffering exhaustion each day. That trip was a lesson in history, nature, music and more. Saw cathedrals and trains and learnt about birds, walked till our feet were sore. His knowledge of each feathered friend was staggering in every sense. He recognised each call he heard, unseen beyond a fence. That trip was 40 years ago, still a highlight in our life. Much has happened since that time, a mixture of great joy and strife. Our friendship forged long years ago, as all earthly things have ends. Through those times, with its ups and downs, we consider the hunts special friends. So, next on the run sheet, which none of you've got, only I've got, is Pastor Lloyd's. Special memorial message for Dad. But before we do that, I'd like to just ask if anyone has any special memories they'd like to recall or retell before we move forward. Chris, maybe? Come down here where the camera can get you. Thanks, mate.
I wanted to stand next to you.
Okay, I'll stand here for you. I just look bigger.
rugby league term, I'm the hooker and he's a...
There you go.
He's a prop forward. Look, I've just got a couple of memories which are not really connected in any way, but this camper van business. He bought a Bedford camper van and he put these Larry stripes, all blue and black stripes, and he put these mag wheels on. Really belonged, really is the sort of thing a surfer would drive. And he said that he was in Tenterfield or Glen Innes, I'm not too sure, and a cop pulled him up. And he used to wear these shorts and long socks and shirt and this tie, which never seemed to match. But anyway, he gets out and he says, what I did was, I got out and I hitched my trousers up, tucked my shirt in and went and said, walked up to him and said, Can I help you, officer? And with that Pommy accent, the cop probably took a double take, expecting to see a long-haired surfer get out. And here's this bloke. And he said, we ended up having a lovely chat. And the cop would probably have a laugh at that. Why I liked that van was because when he was actually ready to trade it in or do whatever, we bought that off him. And we had two littlies, and it was a pop top. A pop top, and you slid timbers along, and there was a bed up there. Our kids thought they were in heaven. We went up home, Mackay, and we got an hour out of Mackay, and it suddenly just started a serious miss.
I think I know what happened to the van, mate.
What?
I learnt to drive in it. I fishtailed that thing, drove it on two wheels.
I wouldn't have bought it if I'd known it either. Because these two, while they don't look much like each other, they really have a neurological problem. comes down the right-hand side of the body. Yeah. And they get this twitch like that. It's not visible, it's neurological. Hey,
she's got it too. And he's got it. And he's got it. But it's part of the DNA.
I don't think therapy would actually help. Anyway, we got an hour out of Mackay, and this thing just... So I thought I'll ask a mechanic, because I knew a few mechanics in Mackay. I asked a mechanic at the place, I've forgotten the name of the place, it's one of those where you blink and you go through it. And he said, oh mate, she's stuffed. Big hand's gone. Big hand's gone. Now this is a 161 hole. 202.
202.
202.
A bulletproof engine.
It had to be a viewer driving it. And I'm thinking to myself, Holden motor, old six motor, there's millions of them. I didn't quite swallow it, so I rang my brother. He towed me into Mackay.
It's Mackay.
Yeah, thank you.
Who's telling this story?
Yes. Anyway, Chris is a native from Mackay. He loves this.
On the front of the Holden motor, there is a fibre gear called a timing gear. And they had a bad habit of, after a while, one tooth, would go out, and so that would change the firing. Da 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 da. That's all it was. Anyway, the other little trivia that I remember is he came through to Mackay one time, and Pat was in a little flat. I think it was before we were married, whatever. And he got into Pat's flat somehow, and he put this beautiful white quilt, was it?
Bedspread.
Massive bedspread. She didn't know he'd been in there. So she walks in, and here is this beautiful, because he had the taste for the frills and he knew the material. It was beautiful, wasn't it? And he did that sort of thing.
He did. For a guy that could do anything with timber or wood or cars, he sewed lace and material and bridal wear and gowns and...
But that's the sort of thing, apart from the other thing about the camper van, that was there were these things stuck everywhere. What's this for, John? Oh, that's in case I want to hang something there when I'm back in there and I want to... Oh, and what's this thing for over here? Oh, but there were things stuck everywhere. I took about...
Did you feel all the buttons?
Anyway, the last thing was... something, a habit that he kept right to the end, and that is his love of flavoured milk.
Yes.
Yeah. Flavoured milk.
Hey, wait, just before we move on.
Yeah.
Phil also knew that. And he especially took a diversion this morning so that everyone could have...
No.
Yes, John's favourite flavoured milk.
What about the corn beef and pickle sandwiches?
No. I'm going to... Yeah.
So what we'll do is, let's hand these out, so whilst Lloyd's preaching, people can be just, you know.
That's it.
Oh, dear.
Well, look at that. Now, when they were up at Crow's Nest, Toowoomba way, he said he's on a diet, And he'd go like this, oh yes, I'm on a diet. You know?
It was a seafood diet.
And
he only ate one meal a day.
One meal a day. Yeah. Well, I was coming into Toowoomba and I said to Pat, I said, there's John in there. He's gone to do the shopping, and then we'd seen, already seen them. And there he is scoffing this carton of flavoured milk. I said, John, I thought you weren't eating in between 99% water. 99%. And guess what he wanted? In fact, the last one was last week, I think.
A few days before he died, I took him a corned beef and pickle sandwich.
His favourite sandwich.
Iced coffee, you know, whatever.
Well, that was the tax we all had to pay. If we went to visit him, yes, we were expected to turn up with at least one or two iced chocolates or iced coffees.
Yes. Well, he was in the hospital there, and he was complaining about the cheese and tomato sandwiches. Oh, they don't make, you know, or peanut butter sandwiches, and they sounded really exciting. Not. And one day he said he'd like to have a sandwich, corned meat and pickle. So I went down to the shop, just the takeaway, and got him this nice corned meat and pickle sandwich on white bread. It just disappeared.
Yes.
Crust and all.
He taught me well. He taught me well.
So, not a complete picture, but just some sparks. That.
Thank you, Chris. Yeah, you. That was an absolute card. He taught me some really important things. He said, if you're going to do it once, do it well. And nothing's impossible if you want to get it done. So whilst Linda... Yes.
He made me a blouse once.
Did he?
A blouse. Yeah, when I was about 12, 14 or something. The sleeves weren't set in real well, but you know, at least he had a go.
He had a go.
That was because he used to look after Dorothy when she was little. He was so practical.
Here we go.
Woohoo! Oh, good one.
Alrighty. So, Pastor Lloyd.
Thank you.
I take it no one else would like to say anything. I know most of my family would rather die than make a speech. Phil, your last chance. All right. Well,
there's one.
Yes.
With the pups. When he came to our place, he took them outside and they had to do a quick for daddy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness. Those words were usually either just in time or just after there was a puddle somewhere on the floor.
Exactly.
Quick. Maybe I should chase my dog.
All righty, Pastor Lloyd. I know we want to give Dad a good send-off, but Pastor Lloyd's got some great words as to where Dad's going and how he'll be. So, mate, thank you. Just wait till the bikes go past.
Okay. I never knew John so well, to be honest. But I do know Phil, his son, a little bit. And I know Andrew, his other son, like my brother. In fact, I was thinking this morning on the way up here, I probably spend more time with Andrew than my wife, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But if his two boys, and I don't know many of you guys very well, and I'm talking about the children, but if his two boys are an indication of what John was like, then his legacy is a fine one, and he was a good man.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's how I see it. Because, and I talk particularly of Andrew just for a moment. I've never met a better man in my life who, and I'm listening to the story of John, the way he would help people, the putting the bedspread on. I can see that in his sons, actually. It's funny how in the DNA, even the good stuff goes through sometimes, doesn't it? So look, I just want to share with you, in fact, I was saying to Hunty this morning, this is the third day in a row that Andrew and I have been to a funeral. So, it's one of those weeks. And one of my really good friends died in Queensland just the other night. And I'm supposed to go up there, but I don't think we can get through. A bit like, it's Harrison, is it, that's stuck up there?
Harrison's in Darwin.
In Darwin.
Yeah.
And we are living in really exceptional times. But I just want to spend 3 or 4 minutes sharing with you the hope that was alive and burning in John's heart. Because this I do know, because as I travel around with Andrew, we talk about all sorts of things. We've talked about his dad. His dad was a man who loved Jesus, who had a relationship with Jesus. He wasn't perfect like the rest of us, You don't have to be, do you? As long as you've got Jesus and you're covered, you're going to be okay. So I just want to share with you, just for a few minutes, the experience. In fact, in one of those sermons, I don't know whether you picked it up yesterday, Hunty, at the funeral, the guy actually said, death is not a full stop, it's a comma.
Yep.
And I really like, I've never heard that before. Death is, so this is not a full stop for John, it's just a comma. So I'll share with you, in Ecclesiastes, this was written probably 4,000 years ago, so it's pretty ancient, this stuff in the Bible here, by a guy called Solomon, who was probably, well, they reckon, one of the wisest guys who ever lived. And this is what he said about death. And this is what John is experiencing right now. Kind of, you know, and Hunty and I talk about this too. We're getting older, eh?
Yeah, mate.
Hey, you share his love of those flavoured milks.
Yeah, but I'm allergic to them, so I can only have a few sips.
Don't be fooled. Many times I stop and buy him a 750ml bottle of caffeinated.
I got to join you up the front here with this.
And he'll drink it from start to finish. And the thing is, he is allergic. I see him have the reactions, and he doesn't care.
Anyway,
he doesn't care.
Now tell me why you buy me the extra large one with the extra coffee.
Because it makes me feel good when I'm drinking the 500ml. I'm not a Hunt, but I do share that joy of flavoured milk with them. And it was a joyful moment for me, actually, when I looked over and saw those flavoured milks turning out to be one of the better funerals I've been to, Andrew.
It's not coronavirus.
No.
Thyroiditis.
Yeah, I have, unfortunately. What a thing to have in the middle of corona, eh? Yeah. So I cough and people think I've got leprosy and head for the...
zombie apocalypse escape.
So this is what John experiences now. This is what the wisest man, the Bible says anyway, whoever lived, said about death. This is verse 5 and it's Ecclesiastes 9. The living at least know they will die. So all of us here, we know we're going to die. But the dead, and this is a bit of a shock to a lot of people, probably not to many of you guys actually, with your Adventist background. But the Bible says, but the dead know nothing. Verse 6, whatever they did in their lifetime, loving, hating, envying, is all long gone. They no longer play a part in anything on the earth. And verse 10, whatever you do, do well, for when you go to the grave, there'll be no work or planning or knowledge or wisdom. He's just gone to sleep. In fact, if you go to John chapter 11, Jesus himself describes death as a sleep. He's just gone to sleep. Now, he was doing it pretty tough, Andrew, is that right?
He did. It lasted a while.
What, last year or...?
Started the end of last year, he was doing it tough.
Really tough.
Broke his hip, couldn't get out of bed.
Yeah.
But all sorts of things.
The broken hip was a real blow.
Yep.
And from what I'm hearing of his life, he was a guy who liked to get around. In fact, the camper van thing too, that surprised me.
Yeah.
No wonder Hunty, he's a camper van guy. You guys all know that, eh?
I've got a coaster bus.
Yeah. Anyway, he's just gone to sleep. And he's gone to sleep after a pretty rough day, to be honest. He had a pretty rough day. I'm just talking, you know, the last year or so. It was a rough day. And most of us went to sleep last night. Most of us, when we go to sleep, we wake up, you know, the next thing, it's morning. Do you know what I mean? Is that what you guys do? You go to sleep? I don't even dream much. Next thing you know, it's morning. Well, that's what's happening to him. He's just gone to sleep, and all the pain and the ravages of old age and sickness are gone. He will never, ever have to face that again. But when you go to sleep, you've got to wake up. And so he will wake up. Now, he believed this, and he could believe it because Jesus was his Saviour. Jesus was not just an idea of something and someone up there. From what I talked to you, Andrew, Jesus truly was his friend. Mm. He'd walk with him. Really? He'd talk with him. He died with his friend. And his friend's going to remember him. I like to think of it like this. God who first made us, Jesus who first made us, he gets our DNA, because he put that DNA, what do they call it? DNA map or thread or strand together. He put John together in the first place. So this is what he's going to do, because John loved him, had given his life to him, this is what he's going to do. Now, I'm just going to read two texts and then I'll finish. Paul who wrote this, now this is 2,000 years old, this one. He writes to two churches, the church in Thessalonica and the church in Corinth. Now, right this moment, if it wasn't for coronavirus, and it was August, Hunty, we were going to go. We were going with Pastor Harker across to Greece and Turkey
Europe.
To film this. This will be one of the stories we're going to film. So what happens in Thessalonica and Corinth, it's a brand new church plant like our one. They don't know much about Jesus. They know nothing about resurrection, really. And they're starting to die, but they know enough about Jesus to know they want him. They've invited him into their hearts, and they're brand new Christians, but they're not real. They don't know all the doctrines. And they start to die, and they're freaking out. And so Paul, who's away from them, but he planted this church, he writes them a letter. And this is what he says. And I think this is applicable for us today, 2,000 years later. Verse 16 of 1 Thessalonians 4. For the Lord himself, this is probably the most famous text in our church, our tribe, Adventism, I reckon, Hunty. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven. So this is, Jesus is going to come. With a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God. So there's going to be lots of noise. And then this is John. This is to John, specifically to him. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. There's going to be a resurrection.
Amen.
And John is going to hear Jesus' voice. You're going to put him back together. Doesn't matter whether you're buried or...
Cremated yesterday.
Cremated
yesterday.
Or died at sea or whatever. It does not matter, because that's not the point. The point is, he who first made you will recreate you. You know what I reckon? One of the big things for me, and I'm 56, I'm 1 year older than Hunty. That's the only reason I'm the boss, I'm a year older. The truth is, don't listen to that rubbish either. He always says that, oh, my boss. But you know what? You guys all know him. Who do you think is the boss on the shoot? Do you think it's me or him?
Who's more stubborn?
Who's more stubborn? Oh, that's
the stubborn stakes are high.
I think it's like two bulls in a china shop. You know why we last together? Because we actually love each other.
Amen.
Him and me.
Yep.
We're not just colleagues. We're friends in this cause of what I'm talking about right now. He's in it with me. And the good thing is, John always supported us, eh?
He did.
I think he's very proud of you.
He, in fact, just last week, Audrey gave us 2,500. I'd like to thank Audrey for that towards the media ministry.
I'm 56. Hunty's 55.
Yep.
He's about to turn 56. I'm about to turn 57. As you get older, this kind of means something to you, I reckon.
Yep.
The older you get, when you're young, you guys, life's gonna go forever, isn't it? Is that what it feels like to you? It does to me when I was young.
I wish.
Oh, you're not feeling like that. They're living in a
work. He just broke his ankle.
On a motorcycle?
No. Getting up from a dinner table.
Oh.
Tired of horses.
Well, sometimes when you're young, it feels. Well, I think we lived in a better life, a better world than you guys when we were young. It seemed like life would go forever, but it doesn't. And the older you get, the more precious this means. And so what Jesus is saying here, and what Paul's saying is, hey, I'm going to come again, and first the believers, this is John who have died, will rise. Then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth, so there will be people alive when Jesus comes. I actually think it's going to be soon. The way the world is, it's gone crazy out there at the moment. Can't believe what's going on out there. In fact, we say this all the time in the car, Hunty. I feel sorry for young people. I shouldn't say this, should I, but... What a world you guys are going to live in. We'll be gone soon, Hunty. We don't have to face it, but man. But there will be plenty of people alive when Jesus comes. He says, first the believers who have died will rise from the graves, and together with them who are still alive and remain on the earth, they'll be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever and ever. So encourage each other with these words. And that's the message I want to leave you with. John loved Jesus. He wasn't perfect. You know, we're good at making saints out of people at funerals. Have you noticed that?
Yep.
But we all know that none of us are perfect. But he given his heart to Jesus. And when you do that, what happens is Jesus comes down. And when your name comes up in judgment, and this is what's happened for John.
Mm.
Jesus just steps forward and says, look, I stand for him. I'm his advocate. So God's looking at John, but all he can see is Jesus. And Jesus is perfect and sinless. He's standing there for John. And God says, welcome to heaven. That's it. And that's what John's experience will be. He's died a good death, actually. We should all be so lucky, eh? I think he was just on the bed. And 88 years of age, good, long, full, wonderful life. On his bed one morning, about to take a tablet, wasn't he?
Just took it, started breakfast.
And just laid back on the bed and
yeah,
died.
Yeah.
We should all be so blessed. Good life, He's asleep now, but because he loves Jesus and Jesus is his Saviour, soon he's going to come. And that'll be the beginning of his new life. It's death is not a full stop. That's a comma. And the sleep John's in now, it's a pretty good one.
Did you pray for it?
Yeah. Lord, I thank you for John and for the love and the life he's given so many of us here this afternoon. I pray now for the family, those who love him the most, that you'll comfort them, that they'll leave this place with hope knowing it's not the end, it's just the beginning, really. He's in a sleep, but it won't be long, and you will come and wake him up. I pray, Lord, that we'll be all there on that great day to see a beloved father, grandfather, and great-grandfather, a brother, a husband. I pray we'll all be there through your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all. I don't know you that much, but I love one of the patriarchs of your family, and I just hope the Lord's with you through this difficult time.
Thank you, mate. So that brings this memorial service to a conclusion. Pat has very thoughtfully and lovingly brought us some yummy finger food. So I know a lot of you've got to rush off, but spend a few minutes, have a little snack, and take a souvenir brochure if you like. Pat and Esther and Chris, I've got some pictures that Dad drew, if you want a souvenir.
Oh, I was just thinking that.
Yeah, that's why I brought them for you guys.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you all for coming. Really appreciate it. And Dad was cremated yesterday afternoon. He's in a better place now. So thank you all for coming. And just, Pat, if you can break open the food,
yes,
we'll continue the celebration.